So here we are at Security Signs, Portland, Oregon. Custom sign manufacturer since 1925. Security Signs is a family-owned business. We are a small-level and large-level sign fabricator. We do specialize in illuminated signs, also do a lot of the interior and facility wayfinding signage that you see around town. So my name is Dylan Martin. I'm the sales manager here at Security Signs. I've been in the sign industry for over 22 years. 19 of those years have been spent right here at Security Signs. Most of our clients are from the Portland metro area. You may know Security Signs from such landmarks as the Hollywood Theater, Providence Park, formerly Civic Stadium, the OHSU Go By Tram sign if you've ridden the tram recently or you've been down at the South Waterfront. Some of these signs are intrinsic to the neighborhood in which they're located and serve. Behind me you might see, you know, formerly the U.S. Outdoors sign was a big one on Broadway. You know, New Seasons Market, local market chain, just to name a few. Did I mention Banfield Pet Hospital? Security Signs started out as a local sign painting company, quickly morphed into what you see around you now. Custom neon, fabricated letters. Of course, nowadays, most of that's LED. We have seen a demand for neon recently. Here are some signs that we're actually crating up to ship to users across the United States. We also have a handful of historical signs here in the shop. Security Signs employs approximately 40 people here. All of these people live in the Portland metro area. We have a variety of backgrounds and trades that are completed here as part of the sign making process. We have installers who are trained with cranes and driving heavy equipment like their trucks, down to their welding certifications and fabrication skills in the field, as well as our fabricators here in the shop who are really like metal artists, right? They're given a set of plans and then they create something that's three-dimensional from those 2D plans. We also have 4 to 5 designers on staff. Those designers obviously have high artistic ability. Their attempt is to create landmarks for our clients, signs that people notice and signs that people like. Here's a nostalgic sign from Pal's Shanty, a local favorite that has since burned down, but we salvaged the sign and fixed it up. Yeah, so this may be the original Jake's famous fish market sign. It's kind of a testament to how long we've been in Portland. You can see behind you is Pizza Schmitza, another local favorite. So what we have here is the original topper to the famous Hung Far Low sign. When we removed it, the sign structure was deemed as unsafe to be reinstalled. So we made an exact copy of this sign, all the way up into the hand painting details on the sign. The new one is all aluminum construction. This one was old sheet metal steel, so you can see all of the corrosion that happens there. And with the aluminum, we don't have any of the oxidation or the rusting that's going to degrade the structural integrity of the sign. One of the problems that we see in recent development is when landmarks go away. Signs that were maybe intrinsic to the community in which they were in, or people identified with as being part of their community. You know, it's interesting, nobody really misses it until it's gone. And then everyone starts asking about where it went. Or maybe there's a preservation effort to take that sign and locate it somewhere else in the community. The problem that you would have there is that most of the current code restrictions would keep you from reinstalling that sign at another location. It was probably there because it was grandfathered. Coming up here is something a little more modern. This is a local hotel that's going through a rebranding effort. So we're using a special lighting application where the lights don't come out of the face of the letters, but actually on the sides of the letters. So these are opaque fronts. They create kind of a halo or silhouette lighting feature. This is something typical that you'll see in Portland here. So you can see in relationship to my size, this is about all you get in Portland without a special land use process, 32 square feet. That's the size of a sheet of plywood. Some of these signs are difficult to get installed or permitted anyhow. The city has kind of this arbitrary rule of 32 square feet that they limit everyone to unless you go through a special land use review process, which can take, you know, 9 to 12 months and cost you thousands of dollars, and you still don't have a sign. That's just for the planning approval process. It doesn't review the structural integrity of the sign or how it attaches to the building, for example. Most of these restrictions, they're not based on safety, they're based on how they look. The city's decided they know best how the city is supposed to look. Therefore, they're going to apply all of these rules to what your sign does and how it looks. Does it move or have flashing lights, and when it should have flashing lights? We're not saying that they shouldn't have some of those restrictions. The problem is that they have a lot of interpretations in place currently that cause even further restrictions to be put in place as far as how they interpret the code and as far as how they implement approval. The one that impacts us the most is the amount of time that it takes for them to review an application. Some of these applications take 6 to 7 weeks for the city to get through, and that's if your sign's within the standards that they want to see and it meets all the little check boxes. If you go outside of that, you could be months going back and forth with the city trying to explain, you know, why this meets the criteria that is formulated in the code. It feels like in recent times the city's really wanted to dumb down the approval process because they don't have the ability to look at each location individually and apply the, you know, the code of how it should look, or, you know, maybe, you know, this is something we should give them. So this star may be familiar to the boating public on the Willamette River. And I can show you the original drawing of that sign. We used to produce drawings by hand. Digital renderings didn't exist at that time. Designs were done by hand by an artist and presented to clients for purchase. So what we have here is an example of kind of the final stages of the sign purchasing process. A lot of the details, like the height or the size of the sign, little notes and revisions were done because you wouldn't completely pitch or, you know, throw away a design like this once you've got it in place because of all the time that it took to produce. Funny is that digital renderings usually take about the same amount of time, but they're not perceived with the same level of value because it's done on a computer versus by hand. Signs like this are absolutely strictly prohibited. Signs that extend past the roof line of a building, for example. This arbitrary 32 square feet comes from a 4x8 sheet of plywood. And what's interesting is that that's a rectangle, right? That's how they measure your sign, from the highest to the lowest point, from the furthest points on a horizontal plane. But the city says that they want creativity, unique signage, but they measure everything within a rectangle. So what's the advantage to you as a business owner to give up square footage in order to create something that's unique when you could use that square footage for the purpose of the sign, which is to advertise? Now, we're all bombarded by advertisements every day, right? Advertisements on buses or on MAX trains or radio or television advertisements. But those all have one thing in common. They're not advertising necessarily to a person in a position to buy that product right then and there at the place it's being advertised. What we do is produce on-premise advertising to customers who are in a position to buy from that business owner. The money stays local. It promotes that local business. It promotes that local bookshop or that coffee shop. Most of the city of Portland's restrictions, as far as it comes to the code, those came about in 1999, year 2000, when we saw this, you know, these digital advertising companies putting up these small electronic message boards. And the city reacted, they overreacted, they tried to course correct, and they created a bunch of language and code restrictions on-premise signage, when what they were really after was this off-premise signage. How that affected business owners is that now it takes longer, and what they're able to do is oftentimes smaller than what they were afforded before. So not only do we have a long and arduous process in order to get the sign permit, you're oftentimes getting something that's smaller than what your business needs to advertise. That can create a whole host of problems, right? I mean, we can create traffic issues by people trying to find a business. Everyone's been stuck behind that driver that's looking around trying to find the local donut shop, and the donut shop's only able to advertise with window vinyl because the building they're in was historic. A building built less than 100 years ago is somehow historic. My grandfather's older than some of these buildings. For me personally, even after 20 years in this industry, every day continues to provide new challenges and creative opportunities. Regardless of the restrictive jurisdictional controls, we're committed to creating meaningful on-premise advertising for our clients, even if it means working through an arduous, time-consuming process with the city. Security Signs has been in Portland for almost 100 years, and we will continue to manufacture and install recognizable landmarks with artistic appeal and effective messaging. Everyone here takes great pride in our contribution to the city's skyline and commercial neighborhoods. But more importantly, we take joy in knowing our efforts and our finished products led to higher revenues and greater consumer awareness for our customers.